entity, as well as to address this business of homecoming. Now, wrongfully so, and admittedly, I sat amongst you for 3 years wondering why any of these alumni should matter to me, and just how exactly any of them had any relation to me whatsoever. You see, I saw this week in this assembly as kind of punitive and really, quite frankly, just vanity. It appeared to me as though the only thing that we have in common with our returning alumni is the title pioneer itself, just that, just one word, pioneer. Now, I've broken this chain of thinking and plan to address it this morning because, unfortunately, it is still alive, so to speak, amongst a few of us today. Now, homecoming, ladies and gentlemen, is not simply a week of school spirit and then a dance. Homecoming is about honoring, above all else, what it means to be a pioneer. Now, being a pioneer, that's a title that should be honored. And when I say honored, let me offer a definition and a reminder of what our true identity is. You see, ladies and gentlemen, we are lions among men. We are a people forged by the sweat of our brows and glorified by the success of our community. Our accomplishments are for all to share, and our festivities are all-inclusive. Our festivities are all-inclusive. Barat did make chorus. You see, we are not a product of our environment. Rather, our environment bleeds green and gold. And finally, ladies and gentlemen, we are the elite of the elite. We are the leaders of the strong. We are, in fact, the greatest students in the world. Besides us. All right, I still got to keep going. Now, we're the greatest not because of any scores on a piece of paper or titles or wins, although these do have an inherent quality of greatness with them. We, in particular, are great, however, because of our commitment to something bigger than ourselves, which is the ideals that the title pioneer brings with it. And the greatest of these ideals is community and fellowship. You see, besides us, there is no one else, and no one will establish themselves over us. And if you don't value this truth and freedom, fellow students, then there's a high school right up the road that would love to have you. You see, that's why our alumni matter. They are not shades of pioneers past, but instead share in the love of this place. Homecoming is about family, ladies and gentlemen, and we are all family here. My challenge is to take hold of what it means to be a pioneer and go forth. Above all, ladies and gentlemen, being a pioneer is a harmonious thing, a body made of equal voices in which there are no weak links and no outcasts. Take hold of these truths and value them. Through this lens, see our alumni and our classmates as they ought to be seen, not as different or similar, but as brother and sister. This is, after all, what has made this school unique, our pride and community. Thank you. I'd now like to invite Mrs. Andrea Marger to the podium.
Today. Well, we're excited for many reasons. First of all, our homecoming games tonight, so that's very exciting. We're very proud of how you have been involved in all of our activities this week. It's great to look out and see green and gold all over. It was great to see red, white, and blue yesterday. So keep your spirit up. We're really proud of you. Today, we're really excited to welcome our alumni back, to welcome parents and faculty, and of course our students to the 2014 University High School Alumni Awards Assembly. I wanted to point out a couple of our very special guests that we have here. First of all, we have the Dean of the College of Education, Dr. Perry Schoen. We have the Superintendent of Laboratory Schools, Dr. Jeff Hill. We have the Director of Development for Laboratory Schools, Liz Adams. And we have the Development Associate focusing on Laboratory Schools, Wilma Bates. As you all are going through this week, I hope you recognize, and I think sometimes it's hard hard to recognize when you're in high school, but I hope you recognize that your school is very different than all other schools in the connection that you still have with your alumni. I went to a high school in Springfield, a much larger school, and there was no alumni connection. The alumni connection you have here is similar to the connection you'll see in colleges, not in high schools. Once you are a pioneer, you are always a pioneer. And that's important. We are very fortunate that we have experienced alumni that stay active in our community and remind us of what we can achieve in the future. And not only do they remind us, they help us achieve it. Our alumni are always available to give you support. So as you listen to our alumni today, don't forget that sometime in the future, and I'm looking forward to 10 years from now, some of you will be back and you'll be speaking to the pioneers. So take the time to listen to what happened to these greatest students in the world after they left the halls of U High. As we continue to grow, we continue to learn, and our alumni are here to share with us their life lessons, their successes, and most of all, their love of U High. We all know that University High School is special. We don't always remember it, but today is a day of celebration of being a pioneer, celebration of the past pioneers, celebration of the pioneers that are here, and celebration of winning our football game tonight. We're privileged to continue to have a strong relationship with our alumni, and I hope you take the time today to talk with them as they come to your classes and find out how U High started their path in life. I would now like to introduce U High alum Dave Off, who's the chairman of the U High Alumni Awards Committee.
Good morning. My name is Dave Off, and I am the chairman of the Awards Committee. I'm a 1985 graduate, and I'm also a former teacher and coach here. My wife is an 85 graduate. My daughter is a 2013 graduate. She's currently in college down in Ave Maria in Florida. And my son Brandon is a junior here, out there somewhere. But it's an honor and a privilege to be here. My family bleeds green and gold, and when I was asked to be a part of this committee, I jumped at the chance. Today is a day that we embrace our history and those who roamed the halls before us. We are here not only to recognize our recipients this year, but to all of the alumni of this great high school. I know of no other high school that has a tradition of celebrating their history as elaborate as the events that U High does. We plan year-round, we read through many nominee biographies, and we carefully select recipients to receive the awards. And it's a daunting task, no doubt about it. We have many outstanding students who make significant impacts and contributions to their field of studies or to their communities. 2 years after I graduated, two teachers, Barb Blunk and Dave Ganaway, both teachers at U High and both graduates as well, started an event called the Fifth Quarter. This was after the homecoming game. They would get together and they would have coffee and cider and donuts. And over the years, the attendance to the Fifth Quarter grew, and they ended up selecting some people to organize the event, and that kind of grew into the Alumni Association that we have today. In 1996, it was established as a permanent organization whose mission it was became to organize the alumni database for contact information. We print a newsletter, and we put together a lot of homecoming events, including today's award ceremony. Today, our Alumni Association is led by President Dave Martin, the 1983 grad. He and the rest of the Alumni Association, as well as the Awards Committee, have worked many hours in putting these events together. However, we couldn't do it without the help of teachers and the administration. I particularly want to thank Dr. Hill, Principal Marker, Dr. Fitzgerald, Mr. Webb, and Stephanie Stork from the superintendent's office for all of their help in putting this together. So let's give a round of applause to these individuals. Our first award is the Alumni Service Award. This award is to recognize the exceptional service of University High School alumni who has made significant contributions to the school or alumni association since graduation. volunteer efforts could be helping one of our many sports teams or clubs, band, chorus, or theater, or being on a committee, such as the Alumni Association. In fact, this year's recipient did just that. After a couple of years assisting with the Alumni Homecoming event, he joined the Alumni Board as the president in training. He then served as the president of the board and then past president, where he would help the incoming president in his new duties. He continued on as the board as a member for an additional 4 years. This year is the first homecoming he's been unable to be at or attend in over 10 years. His participation on the board was interrupted so that he could pursue a master's degree in information technology full-time while working full-time at State Farm. And that followed a relocation and a new job to Dallas, Texas. This year's recipient, Herb Todd, is a 1982 graduate, and he stated, "I consider it a distinct privilege to be able to serve with the outstanding students, administration, and alumni to ensure UHI is able to continue excelling in education." Due to his relocation in Dallas, Texas, Mr. Todd cannot be with us today. However, I'll accept this award for him and make sure that it gets down to him in Texas. So congratulations, Herb Todd. Our next award is the Pioneer Hall of Fame Award. This award recognizes alumni who has made significant accomplishments or shown promise in his or her chosen field, leadership qualities, or evidence of civic, cultural, or charitable involvement. This year we have three recipients. Our first recipient has over 27 years of experience in teaching. Allison Mouton is a 1982 graduate of UHI. Taking French classes here effectively changed her life and her focus. She went on to college at the University of Florida and moved to France right after obtaining her Bachelor of Arts degree in French. She teaches English, and while teaching abroad, she created an exchange program where she brings sixth grade students here to the Twin Cities for a couple of weeks. Because she is domiciled in France, Mrs. Mouton could not be here today. However, Dr. Fitzgerald and I had a chance to meet with her last spring when she brought one of her exchange groups here. While she was here, we had her come over to the Lincoln Library, and she taped a short video for you. So with that, Allison Mouton.
Hello, UHI. I am Allison Hittner Mouton, and I would like to thank you for giving me this award, and I'm here to tell you a little bit about how I am where I am today and how it is linked to UHI. First of all, it's a great honor for me to speak to you. UHI really did shape my world and who I am today, as it will you. It all started when I was a little girl living in Florida. My parents pretended they were speaking French when they didn't want my sister and me to understand, and I felt a lot of frustration at that and thought, I need to learn that language. When I moved to Normal in 1976, after living in Tennessee for 4 years, I remember my parents being so relieved when we were accepted into the laboratory schools. I think they were afraid that the 4 years in school in Appalachia had turned us into country bumpkins forever. I was in the sixth grade and my sister was in ninth grade. French was offered and I took it at Metcalf beginning in sixth grade. I remember a very old woman coming to teach. She was French. She entered the room and said, "Bonjour," and we said, "Bonjour, madame." I continued studying French under Mr. Boyd here at UHI. He was very patient with me as I often pretended I was sick and ran off to the nurse's office during his class. He got on to me and confronted me one day and asked if I disliked French. Well, au contraire, although it did take me years to use the imparfait and the passé composé right. Maybe that was what was giving me a stomachache. I really did like the subject, and I took French every year while I was here at UHI. One day in the winter of my junior year, I was walking down the hallway near the counselor's office and saw a poster advertising for the AFS program, American Field Service. It was a program to go abroad. That poster literally jumped out at me. I was afraid of rejection and didn't really think I met the standards for the program, but thought to myself, why not? Worth a try. I had nothing to lose, and little did I know it would be a game changer for the rest of my life. I applied, went through interviews, got accepted in the program, and then had to choose three countries in order of preference. At the time, France was a very popular destination. I didn't think I would get my first choice, but I did. I was so excited and honored. Early June 1981, my parents drove me to Chicago, and off I flew. I spent 2 months there and knew that was where I wanted to live and work. I came back here, finished high school, went to college in Indiana and in Florida, where I majored in French. And once I got that diploma, I was back in France. I started there as a babysitter, then a waitress, and then a teacher, all within the first 2 years. I was one of the pioneers in the development of bilingual classes in the western part of France in the late 1980s. I later moved to the Lyon region, where I have worked most of the past 20 years. My career has allowed me to give back to UHI and Metcalf what was given to me. Since the 1990s, I have been back and forth, bringing students from France to stay in families in the Bloomington Normal area. In the 1990s, I worked directly with Mary Witherow, who was a PE teacher when I was in high school, but had changed to French over time. What a wonderful feeling to be working with my former teacher and bringing my ninth graders from Lyon. I stopped bringing students here for several years when I moved to Asia and Northern Africa, where I also taught. For the past 4 years, I have been bringing sixth graders and working with the Metcalf staff. And I thank Amy Fritz and Kaufman for supporting this program and working with my school in Lyon, France. We are hoping to include UHI in a very near future through the help of Jim Potter. These programs have touched many lives on both sides of the Atlantic. Some of my former students are now working in New York and other places in the USA. And some Americans have come to France to visit and explore Europe, all thanks to the experience they had with the Twin Cities. I am forever grateful to the lab schools, and particularly UHI. Who knew that day I walked down that hall that my life would be completely transformed and that my link to Metcalf and UHI would continue over the years in such a concrete manner? Reach for the stars. Reach as far as you can. Take risks. Seek opportunities and trust in yourself. A UHI education will give you wings. Soar, young people. Thank you.
And it was a great pleasure to meet with her and talk with her as well. The second of our three Hall of Fame award recipients is an extremely talented musician and singer. Pokey Lafarge, who was known as Andrew Heisler in school, is a 2001 graduate of UHI, and he's known throughout the world as a top performer in traditional American music. Now, when I say traditional, think early jazz, 1920s blues. If you've not heard his music, search for his band on YouTube. His band is named after him, Pokey Lafarge. He has a great talent, and he has showcased his music on the APM live radio broadcast of A Prairie Home Companion with Garrison Keillor, as well as being on Conan O'Brien and Late Night with David Letterman. He has also performed in a few prestigious halls, such as the Ryman Auditorium in Nashville, Tennessee, and Radio City Music Hall in New York City. Unfortunately, he cannot be here. He was originally scheduled to be here and talk to you, but he was able to book a gig last night. Out of state, he could not be here. However, he did send a video, and just for the record, I would not suggest that you guys try to record a video in the manner that he did. So here is Pokey's video.
Hello, this is Andrew Heisler, aka Pokey Lafarge, UHI class of 2001. I want to thank the alumni for inducting me into the Alumni Hall of Fame. It's quite an honor, one that I'm very sorry I cannot be there personally to accept, as I'm out here on tour, traveling around the world, playing my brand of American music for audiences everywhere out of St. Louis, Missouri. And I guess I'm doing what it is that got me in the alumni in the first place. Again, I'm very sorry I can't be there. I want to thank my father for being there to accept the award on my behalf. I want to thank him and my mother, my stepmother, Kathy, my one of big old family, too many people to name, my grandma Heisler especially. I know she wishes I could be there personally. I'd also like to thank my high school teacher, specifically my history teacher, Jim Kinsella, who saw the creative spark in me from a young age, and knew that I had very specific interests and specific drive and passion, and he knew how to get the best out of me, and I'll never forget that. I want to remind all you young men and women that high school is only a small 4 years out of your life, and there's a big world out there. Chase your dreams, follow your dreams. You can be whoever, whatever you want. You can do anything you want, as long as you work hard for it, as cliche as that may sound. I want to wish you all the best. Hope to meet you all someday soon. Thanks again for this prestigious honor. Take care.
Dave was asking earlier, Pokey Lafarge, like, okay, where did that come from? And family members here, I think, would back me up on this. So Pokey was one of those guys that was always the last one out of the house. Last one to the van, he always had a different schedule. We didn't know what it was at the time, but he was a dreamer. And he was working through those dreams in his head, you know, what he wanted for his life. And it had paid off, but it comes down to hard work. What's the dream you have for your lives? And it just takes hard work. And if you have drive and passion, success is just secondary because you're doing what you love anyway. So I'm here to accept the award on Pokey's behalf. This was actually the first time I saw this video. I don't get to see the guy that often because he works that hard, travels around the world, loves being on the road, playing his brand of music to whoever's willing to listen. And so I thank the staff, the faculty, the alumni committee, Dave, for this great honor, and Pokey thanks you, as he did in his video. I'm here to accept the award on his behalf. Go Pioneers. There we go. The third of our three Hall of Fame recipients is an extremely talented soccer player. A 2000 graduate of University High School, Chase Hilgenbrink was a three-time All-Stater in soccer as well as an All-American. He went on to play soccer in college at Clemson University in South Carolina, where his team won the Atlantic Coast Conference Championship. After graduation, Mr. Hilgenbrink moved to South America to play professional soccer. He did very well for several years down there before coming back to the U.S. here to play for the Colorado Rapids in Denver and the New England Revolution in Boston, Massachusetts. And then he heard his calling, and he suddenly left the sport of soccer to go into a new profession. Any guesses? He left to go to the priesthood. After studying for many years, Chase, that is Father Hilgenbrink, became a priest just this year with the Peoria Diocese. And he's here with us today. Please welcome Father Chase Hogan.
Since then. I remember sitting on some yellow ones where the foam was falling out. But I do remember sitting in those seats and dreaming, like Pokey said, dreaming about my future, about what that might hold, and dreaming really about greatness, maybe receiving an award one day. I even thought about receiving a Hall of Fame award from this very school. But it's not about the award itself, and it never was about the award itself. Like your president said, that might be called vanity. However, the reality is that I wanted to win an award like this because it would have meant that I would have achieved something excellent in my life. I would have done something. I would have traveled a long journey. I would have done something that would have been excellent in my life. And I think that one of the things that we do have in common, like your president said, the only thing we have in common is that we're pioneers. I respectfully disagree. We are all created for greatness. We are created to do very important things in this life, and we have a dignity that's beyond something that we might ever know. But the reality is that U-High does not provide that dignity. Neither does anything that we do in our life. But U-High, I remember very fondly as a place that fostered that feeling of greatness, that gave me an opportunity to achieve the things that I had dreamed of. The president talked about what a great place this is and how we want to be elite. We want to be the best. We want to be the greatest. That's the attitude that we must have in order to achieve our dreams. The question I have for you today, one I want you to ponder, is what happens when you don't? Who are you then? Or maybe like in my circumstances, what happens when you do achieve your dreams, when you do become excellent in something in particular? And it doesn't satisfy you. Then who are you? Who will you become after that? I had the opportunity to become an All-American in high school, to play for the U.S. national team, to finish twice in the top 10 in the country in college, to play professionally for 4 years in the country of Chile, to win a championship, to be named the best player in my position for 2 consecutive years, to come back to the United States to play in Major League Soccer in front of my friends and family for just 1 year. But I left in my prime. People thought I was crazy. 26 years old, leaving the sport. But it was because I realized that after achieving all of this success, all of my dreams, living that out, coming to a moment where I realized that I couldn't be happier, humanly speaking. There was no way that I could have been happier in my life. But then in a moment, realizing that I wasn't satisfied, that there was still something more. There was something beyond my dreams. There was something beyond us. If you never stand where I'm standing today, will you be less of a man than me, or less of a woman than me? Will you be a failure? Absolutely not. Your dignity doesn't lie in the awards that you receive. Our world tells us often, our society tells us often, that we are what we do. Depends on how much money you have, how many wins you have, what kind of house you have, what kind of car you drive. But I'm here to tell you that whether you end up in jail, whether you end up homeless, whether you're handicapped, whatever it may be, your dignity does not change. You were bought without price. You always have a second chance to be great, to turn around, to come back, and to be the best person that you can be. And that's the goal of life. It's not receiving awards. It's about the journey that we're on. Life does end in this world, but I believe in life eternal. I often say life is changed, but it's never ending. you have an opportunity to live your lives in a similar way. I don't know if all of you believe in God. I certainly do. And it's my prayer, and it's been my prayer for you, knowing that I would come here and to encounter you, that you would see a dignity in yourself that is beyond awards, that's beyond your achievements, and that one day you would realize, like me, that there is life beyond your wildest dreams. Thank you.
Distinguished Alumni Award. This award recognizes the exceptional achievements of a U High graduate who has made significant contributions to his or her profession, community, state, or nation. This year's recipient is Dr. Norman McCormick. Dr. McCormick is a 1956 graduate where he had won the Bausch & Lomb Honorary Science Award. After graduation, he attended the University of Illinois, where he received his bachelor degree in 1961 in mechanical engineering, and then 1 year later, a master's degree in nuclear engineering. In 1965, he earned his doctorate in philosophy in nuclear engineering. A lifelong teacher and a professor at the University of Washington in Seattle, Dr. McCormick is an active member of the community, has won many awards, too many to list here, and has authored and co-authored two books and many publications. Traveling all the way from Seattle, Washington, your 2014 Distinguished Alumni, Dr. Norman McCormick.
Let me begin by saying that I'm peeping with envy listening to Chase's previous remark. I didn't start playing soccer until I was 38, and I had to quit playing, even though it was over 60 division men's soccer, several years ago because of my knees. So my point is, be careful, you guys in the front row here. Take care of your body. Also, emphasize that coming from Seattle, where the Sounders play, probably, I certainly have seen you on television, and I'm in awe. That shows you what people do when they change their career decisions, and we're going to talk about that a little later. I want to start out by recognizing a couple of my favorite math teachers, Drs. Douglas Bay and Toivo Ryan, as well as my senior English teacher, who else but Ruth Stroud, who was beloved by all the students for her passion for learning. Although I must confess that I don't remember details of the Shakespeare plays that we read, I do remember how she methodically dissected the development of each play as a detective would. In 1956, if you can imagine how long ago that was, the year I graduated, she was very proud of the fact that U High was a high school that for nearly 100 years without its own building. Because I was a student in her senior English class in 1956, she would frequently remind us of how grand it would be if Adlai Stevenson, a U High graduate, running for President of the United States, was elected. Perhaps one of you will fulfill that dream and run for the toughest job on earth. It's a humbling experience to address exceptionally qualified students like you who attend U High. The issue is complicated for me by the fact that you're all highly motivated to excel and already have received career guidance from U High counselors and, I'm sure, also from your parents. I'd like to give you a personal perspective. Bloomington Normal as it was when I was here. Notice the statistics here with regard to the population then and now. Need I point out that we've had some changes in the population, and we certainly have had additional changes in the population in the U.S. and also in the world. So what's the real message here? The real message, if you looked at the previous slide, or this one as well, is that the Earth is greatly expanding in population. There somehow has to be some control here. Zero population growth is as important, or more important, than the climate change model, in my belief. Also, if you'll notice the changes in the ethnic diversity, these are other very common occurrences now. And one of the things that marks a U-Hi graduate is the ability to be flexible. And Chase just gave us an example of going from making a major career change, going from one life experience to another. Let me talk a little bit about life in general. What you see here is that in that era, mid-50s, we had very limited radio. We had WJBC and very limited television. Now, of course, you can get access to hundreds of channels. I was struck by the fact that Veterans Memorial Parkway, Veterans Parkway, I guess you call it, was the part of the old Route 66. That was impressive to me as a kid growing up, going through Metcalf and U-Hi. That was a four-lane road. Well, that's a pretty big deal in that era. And now, of course, we have interstates all over the place. We also have, for example, an example is how computations were done in that era. And for example, how does one do multiplication in the 50s? Well, either by hand or with a slide rule. Now this, folks, is a high-tech device from the 50s. Let me tell you, this cost me $25 after I graduated when I went to the University of Illinois. This is $25. Well, that's the price of a medium-grade laptop today. Now, the slide rule, however, this is a pretty sophisticated device. You can look it up in Wikipedia. I'd encourage you to do so if you want to know how they work. And it gives you 2 or 3 decimal place accuracy, which is pretty impressive in the mid-50s and early 60s. I hasten to point out, however, that much of the space shuttle work, in fact, we put a man on the moon, and most of that design is done with one of these. I must be one of the few people that missed the opportunity to post this on Craigslist and sell it. Anybody want to buy it? Let me continue here by pointing out that we have lots of handheld calculators. So what's the message here? The message is, try and imagine what life is going to be like if you're here. Now, hopefully you'll be here before you're 75, like I am. But if you come back here, say, 25 years, what's life going to be like? We'll still have, hopefully, the murals on the walls and the same auditorium. Probably will be reconditioned seats since earlier we learned that it was rehabilitated. Let me talk now more specifically about U-Hi and the population then. student population of about 400. The graduating class that I was in 56, and a few of my good friends here, the advantage of coming back is that I can have a mini reunion and we can talk about old times, including some of the beginning sports that were developed, including wrestling and golf that were minor sports at the time. And golf is a very major sport here, wrestling as well. But of the 100, approximately 100 students that graduated in my class, there was only one non-Caucasian student. So this is an example of the improvement in society. It's good that you see these things now because the world is becoming very much more interconnected. Okay, let me give you a couple of other thoughts. The information universe. It's amazing to me what you can see on your laptop or your phone, for that matter. I don't need to tell you that it's very easy to lose a lot of valuable time and lose a lot of focus if you look into such, if you look at that too much. But it's a wonderful resource, much of which, you know, Wikipedia is an individually contributed thing, but encyclopedias are now online, updated. You don't have to worry about buying extra things. You don't see a bookshelf about three or four feet long, just 35 separate printed volumes of the last edition of Encyclopedia Britannica, for example. Anyway, so the objective, in my perspective, is caution to you is try to stay focused. It's just too hard to learn everything that you might learn, as well as doing the things that you're supposed to be doing to pass your next exam in UHUD. Let's talk a little bit about STEM, science, technology, engineering, and math. There's been a lot of emphasis on that more recently, in about the last 5 to 10 years. It certainly is important that you try to stay abreast, at least generally, as to what's happening in the technology field, because that's going to influence where you may want to invest in the stock market or where you're in, whatever job career path you might want to pursue. It's here, it's happening, and let me tell you, from my perspective at least, if you think about this and you think about what's available in your head, in your hands when you're looking at your smartphone instead of listening to what I'm telling you. The state of the art is so great that just read the newspaper. You don't have to read science fiction. Science fiction is happening today. Finally, if you don't need to major in one of these four fields, but at least you should be trying to stay abreast as a participant in society. Now, if you do broaden, do major in a field like this, then be sure to try and stay broad, because the broader your background, the better able you will be to interact with the peoples of the world, many of which don't even speak English. Okay. So, question is, how do you decide what you want to do when you leave UHAR? Well, Chase was an example of someone who was extremely successful in the sports field. Picked the right sport, by the way. But made a major change in his life. But there are concerns here, in part that you do want to have some sense of satisfaction that you're able to compete. So, for example, I never dreamed of trying to become a brain surgeon because I don't have the kind of mind that fits that. One of the key things I think to think about is what kind of personality do you have and what are your special strong strengths. In any case, the message here is try to do what you enjoy. But don't be afraid to take risks because it may be necessary, job change, moving, or whatever, maybe a change in life, your partner moves to another part of the country. You have to be flexible. You may not be doing 3 to 5 years later what you first started doing when you graduate from your last level of schooling. So try to stay flexible, and but don't worry about taking risks when changing your career path. And finally, you see that we have a football game tonight. Who would we play? Are we going to win? Oh, come on. I'm sure a lot of other people are going to come. All right.
Ceremony. I want to thank the alumni, the administration, and especially to you, our future alumni, for graciously attending. And as for tonight's game, let's go you. I'm going to hand the podium back over to your student body president, Mason Averly.
I think after hearing everything today, we're just left with a couple of thoughts, right, in meditato or in hereafter. The common themes we've heard are, I think, first and foremost, and the greatest of all them, is just to follow after the passions that have been written on your soul, whether you believe that's from eternity or your own creation. That's something that should be pursued and that should be sought after diligently. So if you'll please join me and just give our alumni one more round of applause. So at this time, seniors, you are dismissed. You're going to your 11 o'clock class. Alumni, if you'll stick around.